Good morning, and welcome to Northminster. This morning is the third Sunday of Lent, the season where we enter the wilderness to hear our demons more clearly and know more skillfully how to greet them when they arise. So today we continue our 40-day sojourn of looking at the demon of violence, of knowing its nature and how the Spirit might inspire us to respond.
As we prepare to enter this time together, we invite you to do whatever needs doing in your space, to get grounded, to be present not just in body, but in mind and in spirit. Take a moment to make sure you have communion elements, a pen and paper, if you'll want them. And when you've found a comfortable seat, breathe in deeply, maybe the deepest breath you've had all day, to ground yourself more fully in the loving presence of the Holy One. And exhale slowly, breathing that love out into the world.
Now, would you join me in our blessing of this time together, this morning based on the words of Paul Robeson. Let us take our voice wherever there are those who want to hear the melody of freedom. Let us take our voice wherever there are those who long to hear words that might inspire hope and courage in the face of fear and despair. Let our weapons be peaceful, for it is only by peace that peace may be attained. In all things, the song of freedom must prevail. So let us now sing. Let us worship God together this morning.
Century hymn writer and mystic Gerhard Tersteegen, whose faith was nurtured in the German Reformed Church, authored our opening hymn. Part of a longer work, these stanzas were published in the Choralbuch in 1825. It is a song of praise for love with a capital L, for God is love. It speaks of the mystical ways in which God's love lives in harmony with our very bodies, our hearts beating to its rhythm. The hymn closes with a prayer that the love of Jesus will create a deep impression in ourselves and that our lives will be pure expressions of that love. A bright reflection of joy in love's own resurrection.
Our prayer this morning expands on the well-known prayer of Saint Francis. Would you pray with me? O divine gardener, make me an instrument of your peace, which is to say, make me useful as the rake that gathers. Make me discerning as pruning shears. Make me faithful and sure as the trowel that digs and lifts. Let the roots of my life sink down deep in the soil of your love. Which is to say, where the weeds of hatred grow unabated, let me sow love instead, and tend it as it sprouts slowly but surely to fill all the earth. Where there is injury, let me be the presence of pardon, a healer, a restorer, bringer of empathy and understanding. Where there is doubt, let me embody the faith that sustains us, faith not in doctrines and creeds, but in the deeper knowledge that the story rings true, that love brings us to life even when death seems to hold sway. Where there is despair, Let me hope in what holds us fast and spread hopefulness through my every endeavor. Where there is darkness and the way forward is unclear, let your love be a beacon, shining its light on our path. And may I be a mirror, reflecting, illuminating, multiplying the light, that the way of love might be made known. Where sadness has taken root, let me till the soil with patience until joy breaks slowly through. O Holy One, grant that I may learn what a gift is the consolation of others, even when I have not found that consoling myself. What a gift is the seeking to understand, even when I have not yet been fully understood. What a gift is the seeking to love and love again, even when I have wished to be loved more fully than what I have known. For in giving, truly we receive. In extending forgiveness, we find our own pardon. And in the death to the self, even the death of these bodies, we know ourselves enraptured, caught up in the song, the holy cacophony of grace that carries us all. O divine song, make me an instrument in your symphony of peace, which is to say, let the melody of my life find its crescendo in your love, in harmony with all creation. Amen.
Thank you. A reading from the 5th chapter of Matthew. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be children of your Father in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the righteous and on the unrighteous. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers and sisters, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. This is one of our sacred teachings. Thanks be to God.
Is anybody there? So we'll use wooden spoons. I don't want to hear anything more about it.
I'm sorry to disturb you.
You caught him.
But I had my eye on this man.
Oh, and... thank God. I'm very angry with you, Jean Valjean.
What happened to your eye, Monseigneur?
Didn't he tell you he was our guest last night?
Oh, yes. After we searched his knapsack and found all this silver, he claimed... that you gave it to him.
Yes. Of course I gave him the silverware. But why didn't you take the candlesticks? That was very foolish. Madame Gillot, fetch the silver candlesticks. They're worth at least 2,000 francs. Why did you leave them? Hurry. Monsieur Valjean has to get going. He's lost a lot of time. Did you forget to take them?
Are you saying he told us the truth?
Of course. Thank you for bringing him back. I'm very relieved.
Release him.
You're really letting me go?
Didn't you understand the bishop?
Madame Gillot, offer these men some wine. They must be thirsty.
Thank you.
Don't forget. Don't ever forget. You've promised to become a new man.
Promise? Why are you doing this?
Jean Valjean, my brother, you no longer belong to evil. With this silver, I've bought your soul. I've ransomed you from fear and hatred. And now I give you back to God.
The wandering rabbi and his disciples, having passed their first night in a new town, gathered the following morning for breakfast, as was their custom. "Good morning," Peter greeted in a groggy voice as he stepped through the archway and into the courtyard. Jesus was already there, preparing a meal of fish and fresh bread over smoldering embers. "Shalom," Jesus greeted good-naturedly. "How was your night?" The rabbi and his disciples often stayed together while traveling, whether in the home of a generous patron or on a nearby hillside, but it did happen from time to time that they had no choice but to split up. One or two would stay in the home of one host, and the rest scattered across other homes throughout the village. "Passed without incident," Peter replied, reclining opposite Jesus near the fire. "Kind family. I left quietly so as not to wake them up." It was at that moment that Peter noticed the plum-colored bruise darkening the left side of Jesus' face. He sat up straight, suddenly at alert. "Rabbi," he demanded, "what happened?" Jesus looked up, thrown for a minute before remembering the bruise. "Ah, yes," he said, touching his face tenderly. "This." "Well, good morning," interrupted a newcomer. It was Joanna, followed by her companion, Susanna. "How was your—" "Good God, what happened to you?" She rushed over, inspecting the bruise on her teacher's face. "Please," Jesus said, shooing them away. I'm fine. You're going to get ash in our breakfast, and then we're going to have a real crisis." Joanna sat down hesitantly. "I was just about to tell Peter," he said. "I was just drifting off when I heard a noise at the window, and I discovered that a thief had broken into my room." "What did you do?" Peter asked. Though he'd never voiced it out loud, Peter had always suspected that, push come to shove, his teacher could probably hold his own in a fight. "Well," Jesus replied, flipping the fish, "I greeted him and I asked his name. He responded, as perhaps one should have expected, by striking me on the cheek." He gestured to his face and shrugged. "Well, I stepped back, of course, and I showed him my palms, and I assured him that I was unarmed and that I meant him no harm, and that I understood completely the forces that might drive one to break into a house. And then, not wanting him to leave empty-handed, I offered him my extra robe, and he was off." "You," Peter started. "I'm sorry, you did what?" "My extra robe," Jesus repeated slowly, as though Peter hadn't heard him the first time. "I gave it to him. He looked surprised, but I assured him that, unfortunately for him, I had nothing of any more value. I told him, of course, I wished I could have given him more, but I sent him off in the direction of Mary, Martha, and Lazarus in the next village over. I told him they were always good for a good night of shelter and a good meal while he got on his feet. And with that, he left, right out the same window." Jesus continued to tend the fish and bread as though he'd just told them that he'd run into an old friend at the market. The disciples, however, sat with their mouths hanging open. "Good morning," John and James greeted, entering the courtyard. "How was your—" "Jesus was attacked by a thief, and then he just gave him his extra robe and sent him off," Joanna blurted. It was more of a compound word than a sentence. "I'm sorry, what?" John asked, understandably dazed. "This will not stand," Peter said, rising. His hands were shaking, steadying themselves only on the hilt of his sword. "We will find this man. You said you sent him off in the direction of Lazarus. So, James and John, if we leave now, we can cut him off at—" "No," Jesus interrupted firmly. "Let him be." Peter looked as though he'd just been struck himself. "Does the law not demand an eye for an eye?" Peter shot back. "It does," Jesus said calmly. "Well, then what do you say to that?" Peter demanded. "I say that should a thief ever break into your home, Peter, and strike you across the face, you should do what you feel is yours to do." He gestured for Peter to sit back down. "The law exists to protect you and to ensure that you are given the justice that you deserve. But Peter, it was not your room. It was mine. And I am far more interested in the recovery of this man's soul than the recovery of my cloak." Peter stood his ground. If you had just struck that man back, then at least he would know more anger, he would know more violence, and he would know more resistance. Jesus interrupted. "We might have spent the whole night, indeed maybe the rest of our lives, fighting, exchanging blows back and forth. But if one is able, Peter, to take that anger and see it, absorb it, to understand it, to refrain from returning it. Then the cycle might be disrupted. And then, "That man is a thief," Peter yelled, incredulous. "The man is a thief, that's true," Jesus said more firmly. "But more true than that, he is a child of God, Peter. He has been beaten down and robbed by this world until he's forgotten what he really is. He has forgotten that he is good, that he is beloved even. If a cloak and a bruised face is the price I must pay to remind him of who he is and what his value is, then I give it without regret or reservation." Peter slumped back down by the fire, crossing his arms in defiance. "I will respect that, Rabbi," he said. "But if someone were to strike me on my cheek, I couldn't imagine. And if your teeth were to suddenly bite your tongue, Peter, would it make you feel better to knock them out?" Jesus asked. He waited, as though there were a way to answer such a question. When Peter remained silent, he went on, "So it is with the thief and I. He's a misguided man, blinded by ignorance and by pain, as we all once were, or could so easily be. But Rabbi," Joanna thought perhaps she might be the one to reason with him, "did God not give us these laws to prevent people getting away with such things, for protecting the survivors?" "That's true," Jesus nodded. "The law of the Lord is perfect," he quoted the psalm, "lighting the eyes, creating justice, and abiding forevermore." "Well, then how can you just disregard it like this?" Joanna asked reasonably. And Jesus looked up, surprised. "Disregard it," he replied. "Joanna, I don't care to disregard anything. I care to fulfill it. The law is perfect and has a perfect role to play, but God is also bigger than the law God wrote. Is that not true?" Joanna considered this. "The law protects people, and that is good, but it is also true that for those willing to go deeper, for those who are able to meet intimately with the one who wrote the law, they will find that the same God who commanded an eye for an eye also sends rain to water the crops of the just and the unjust alike. They will find that the same God who commanded just recompense for crimes also sends the sun to light the way for the bad man as well as the good, without judgment and without discrimination. As far as I can tell, Joanna, God is a God of infinite chances, loving thieves into saints and forgiving 70 times 7 the wrongs that were done. That same law you quote also states that we are to be as perfect as God is. Is that not correct?" Joanna was confused and, to be honest, pretty annoyed. "So if we were struck on our face, you expect us to just, what, let it go?" "You are to do," Jesus said calmly, "what is yours to do." He served a few pieces of fish into wooden bowls. "I deal not in guilt or shame, but in wisdom. If you have known God's Spirit in one place and time, and she inspires you to make protest, by all means, make protest. If you have known God's Spirit in another place and time, and she gives you the capacity to take a blow without returning it, then take the blow. You will not find me writing any new laws for any who choose to follow me, save one. Love one another. However is right in that moment, and with whatever grace you have received." He passed the bowls around, followed by the fresh bread, and blessed the food. For a few moments, they ate in silence, spiritual tension drowned out by physical hunger. When someone finally did speak again, it was Peter, between mouthfuls of bread. "Rabbi," he said, shaking his head, almost playful on a full stomach, "I respect you, but I also worry about you. Such an attitude may one day be your death. By the logic you follow, Rabbi, men could crucify you and you would allow it. You would even forgive them for their ignorance every step of the way, hoping in vain for the redemption of their souls. Who knows, Jesus said, taking a breath. It may yet be. And then he shot back with an equal measure of play. However, if such grace is to be considered vanity, then let me be counted among the most foolish. Everybody laughed, except Joanna, who stared at him. You're joking, she said. But you really mean that, don't you? Jesus smiled. But before he could answer, Andrew shuffled into the courtyard. Good morning, he said, stifling a yawn. Any breakfast? Good Lord! Andrew stopped short. Rabbi, what happened to your face? Oh, good grief, John sighed. Are we really to do this again? Jesus offered Andrew a piece of broken bread. As many times as it takes, John, Jesus replied. As many times as it takes.
Thank you.
Children of God, in this Lenten season, we become aware that we too often spend our money on that which is not bread, and our labor for that which does not satisfy.
The food offered us by the world is empty of nourishment, and the drink makes us weak rather than strong. That is why we gather around this table, to eat what is good, to delight in rich food.
Around this table, we offer only the food that really nourishes, the bread of love, which Jesus broke and offered to all people.
Around this table, we find the only drink that helps us grow, the cup of grace, which Jesus poured out and promised to all.
Emptying ourselves to receive this sustenance, may these gifts sustain us as we sojourn in the desert. Amen.
God, in whom we move and live and have our being, who is above, below, all around, and within us, your name is beautiful. God, reign in our hearts and our actions. We thank you for the world you created, for its beauty and knowledge. Infuse us with your love, promising eternal life, both now and forever. Feed us all with life-giving sustenance. Free us from the guilt of our wrongs as we free those who have wronged us. Help us avoid the distractions of the material world. Protect us from dangers of body, heart, mind, and spirit. We believe these petitions can be so through your loving grace. Amen.
Thank you for being with us this morning. We hope that we have created a space for you to hear God's Spirit more clearly in the laboratory of your own life, and that you might now go and live the story of hope that she inspires. In a moment, we'll sing our closing hymn and give the benediction, but before that, we have a few announcements.
This afternoon, the Worship Commission invites you to a self-guided, in-person service of reflection in the sanctuary between the hours of 4 and 5 p.m. So this won't look like a typical service, but we do hope it will be a way to ease back into gathering in our sanctuary. Everyone who attends is asked to come and go between 4 and 5 this afternoon and to spend no longer than 15 to 20 minutes enjoying the music and guided contemplation. So that means that arriving anywhere between 4 and 4:45 will still put you right on time, and we actually hope that arrival times will be staggered so that our greeters don't have to turn into bouncers. Although they will be watching closely so that we don't exceed a safe capacity. And there's a chance you may be asked to wait outside for a short time. Please be gracious with them. Of course, masks and social distancing will be required of everyone, even those who've been vaccinated. And we hope that if you feel safe attending, that this will be a meaningful time for you. And if you're not there yet, know that we are looking forward to expanding opportunities like this in the days ahead as vaccines become more widely available. If you've been meaning to join us on Wednesday nights for book study, it's not too late to jump in. The book is very straightforward and a quick read. The harder part comes in putting it to good use, and that's what we're hoping to help each other do as we continue the conversation with chapters 6 through 8 this Wednesday at 5:30. And as we say every week, if here you have found hope or community or healing in this space, we invite you to please consider supporting us financially so that we'll be able to continue creating more spaces like this in days to come. You can donate by scanning the QR code on the screen, or you can always visit northmen.org/give.
Now, before we offer our benediction, please join us for our closing hymn.
Seeing a need for a hymn that expresses the powerful words of Jesus in today's text and being unable to find one in our hymnal nor through an internet search, D.H. Clark set this metered paraphrase of Matthew 5 to the familiar tune Nettleton, most commonly used with the hymn, Come, O Fount of Every Blessing. As in last week's closing hymn, we are reminded that genuine love for humanity is action, requiring real work to love and serve all. Just as God's sun and rain fall upon all, just and unjust alike, doing that work while walking humbly with God in the path that Jesus trod. Thank you.
us and we hate our enemy. We forget what Jesus taught us, what true Christian love should be. Jesus tells us, love your enemies, pray for us who persecute. Loving all is never easy, but his will loves just pursuit. If we're truly God's own children, soul share God's light shining on us all. Cleansing rain falls on all people, whether righteous, whether not. Universal peace and justice is God's goal that should be sought.
People of God, receive this benediction, again based on the words of Mohandas Gandhi. If we, with courage and vision, can rise to lead in nonviolent action, the winter of despair can be turned into the summer of hope. It is possible to live in peace. Nonviolence is not a garment to put on and off at will. It is a seat in the heart, and it must be an inseparable part of our being. It is possible to live in peace. Nonviolence is a quality of the heart, not an appeal to the brain. It is a plant of slow growth, growing imperceptibly but surely. It is possible to live in peace. The future depends on what we do in the present. And it is possible to live in peace. Children of God, you are seen and you are loved. Go in peace.